Hi friends, welcome to next session. Hello friends, welcome to next session on RHCSA, on RHEL 8, brought to you by skillpedia.co. Visit the website skillpedia.co to see the courses being offered at Skillpedia. A lot of courses available here. If you go to the home page, you will see categories of courses even. So these courses are on various categories like cloud computing, databases, Linux, core technologies, DevOps. And blog is a very good place where you can find out various hands-on labs like virtual machines with KVM, OpenStack Victoria 3 node cluster setup. So these are hands-on lab with screenshots and examples given. Even the labs which I've been using, the demonstration which I've been using, they are basically coming from my lab assignments. And those labs are available on the blog. CSA certification series. Automated installation options for RHEL 8 or CentOS 8. My name is Ram. We are on part 2, automated installation options. Part 2 is virtual machine and automated installations. We have done 2 sessions on this, virtualization with KVM done, session 7 configuring virtual networking done, and this session is automated installation options. We are going to talk about this in the session. 9th session will be secure shell and secure copy, SSH and SCP, and then session 10 will be some command line tools. Agenda of this session is automated installation options, kickstart concept, setup local access to kickstart file, setup network access to kickstart, and guidelines for a kickstart file and understanding a kickstart file. Automated installation options. Kickstart is what? It's a Red Hat solution for automated installations. Like if you want to deploy hundreds of systems with same configuration, with same set of software, then you can deploy using Kickstart. How it works? It's quite simple to understand it. Whenever you install CentOS 8 or RHEL 8, you respond to some questions which installer asked during the installation time. The installer will capture the answers of those questions and will create a response file or a file where these questions and the answers will be placed. The same file is a very good starting point to create kickstart file. How it works? The same file, after a modification based on your need, you can supply to the installer, and then installer will not ask you anything, will take the questions from the kickstart file. So with kickstart, you can set up identical systems very quickly. To that end, kickstart file are useful for quick deployment and distribution of Linux systems. With the advent of virtual machines, it's not difficult to set up an automated installation on a new virtual machine with the help of kickstart. Kickstart concept. Kickstart based installation does not include the custom settings created after the basic installation was complete. There are 2 methods of creating the required kickstart configuration file. One, as I told you, there's a file with the name anaconda-ks.cfg which is available in the root directory, that is home directory of root user /root. And second is you can use a graphical kickstart configuration or configurator accessible via system config kickstart command. It's relatively easy to customize the anaconda-ks.cfg for the different systems. And we need to look at this file and we'll see actual example of using this kickstart file in a network-based installation for our demonstration purpose. Set up local access to kickstart. Once the kickstart file is configured, you can set it up on local media such as USB key, CD, or a sparse partition or a spare partition. First step, configure and edit anaconda-ks.cfg as desired. Second, mount the desired local media. You may need to run a command such as fdisk-l as the root user to identify the appropriate device file. Third, copy the kickstart file to ks.cfg and mount it on local media. Make sure the ks.cfg file has at least read permissions for all users. Be aware that kickstart configuration file on FTP server may be a security risk because this file normally contains root administrative password. Boot the RHEL 8 or RHEL 7 installation DVD. When the first menu appears, highlight Install Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7 or 8, then press Tab key, go to the end of the line similar to this line and make some changes into that. Add the information for the location of the kickstart file to the end of the line. For example, the following addition indicate that the file kickstart file is located on USB drive hd-sdb1ks.cfg. Alternatively, if it is on a boot drive or a CD-ROM, you can specify ks is equal to cd-rom-ks.cfg. Or if it is on a floppy drive, you can use even fd0, old method, quite old. We have to, we used to work with this. In fact, we can serve this kickstart file using PXE boot also, directly available under the installation tree, which I'm going to show you. In my case, I'm using it on that. There may be some trial and error with this method. Yes, device files are generally assigned the sequence SDA, SDB, SDC, so you have to identify which device file your system is using. Set up network access to kickstart. This is what I'm going to demonstrate, and this is where I'm going to where I have put my ks.cfg file. It is efficient to set up kickstart file on a network server. One logical location is same network server used for installation files. I'm going to show you how to set up this installation tree, how to set up this network server, and where I'm going to also demonstrate how to set up the kickstart file. For example, assume there is a ks.cfg file in your FTP server's where FTP pub directory. You need to set up SA Linux context that should match that of that directory, which can be confirmed with the following command ls-zd for directory context and uppercase z ls-z for only normal files. Once the appropriate ks.cfg file is available under where FTP pub, then you can specify this URL installation, that is inst.ks is equal to FTP :// the IP address and pub ks.cfg. Similarly, I've been using this web server where my web server is 192.168.122.1. Under that, I put my ks.cfg file and I have set it correctly. Guidelines for a kickstart file. Before we get into the detailed discussion of the guidelines of the kickstart file, we need to understand, we need to take a look at that kickstart file and the setup on my system, which I have configured for the automated installation using kickstart. So we'll come back to this slide, but let's first understand the setting up, because that will be very important for you. And same steps are given and explained and available on the blog of the website skillpedia.co. Just change my settings so that you see a bigger font size. Let's make it 14. Now here you see there are files which I created: firewall settings, HTTPD settings, so that I put the commands, all the commands in one go, and I can show you that where my files are available. So let me show you the files, FTP settings. What you need to do is you need to install the packages for FTP server, VSFTPD, TFTP server. Why I installed this package? I installed this package to serve this kickstart file through PXE boot and change the context on where FTP for setting up the FTP server. Then set some boolean, allow FTP full access 1, restore context on where FTP and installation directory. Then change to the directory, then copy the file from your installation media where it is mounted. I mounted my DVD on /MNT. The two files are very interesting file to note, .diskinfo and .treeinfo. These two files are mandatory, which are generally not available. You have to copy them to WAR-FTP. Other than that, you can verify that what are the configuration setting, default configuration. Let me show you. This is interesting observation. Let me show you what we have here. So these are non-commented line of my VSFTPD, that is FTP server. Anonymous enable, yes. Local enable, yes. Write enable, no. Local UMAS 022. These are the default setting which I put. So you have to make changes accordingly. Take note of these details. Then what I used is, I showed you this file also, where, let me show you what I have in this file, in the directory. CD, and you see ls-al, the files available, that is .diskinfo and .treeinfo. What are the SE Linux context on these files? ls-zd dot, so this is the current context. Let me see ls-zd on this directory. Okay, let me write A also and long list also. So this is the current directory, and if I use all the directories, if I go back and you see the current directory context is this, and if you see all, you see the current directory context of all the directories, all the files in the directory. If you want to see the files, you just remove hyphen D and then you use this ls hyphen za, that will show you the context. If I use ls hyphen al and then z, you can see the individually SE Linux context on that. Public content T, right? Public content. So that's a very interesting point to observe, that you have to set the right context, because my SE Linux is enabled and I have set the context, right context, public content. So this is the second, the public content. And then this is the location where I have put my TFTP boot. So let me show you what I have under this directory, CD. And go to this directory. What I have in this directory is these two files, initrd.img and vmlinuz. From where did I copy them? I copied them from this directory, ISO Linux. Under that you file these directories, these files. In it, that is this file is initial RAM disk and this file is the kernel. So, and you can see that copy MNT images, vmlinuz, that is kernel, to varlib tftp centos 8, and then under images pxc boot initrd varlib pxc tftp boot centos 8, and change the context again. Then interesting point is this location, this file. Go to this directory and open the file varlib, because this file is actually my menu. This file present me the menu of my installation. So when I start installation with pxc boot, this file is fetched. So varlib tftp boot pxc linux .cfg, under this directory the default file, and this is the menu which you see. Timeout is 300 seconds, menu.32c32, and pxc boot brought to you by Skillpedia. The first option is boot CentOS, install CentOS 8 from the FTP server, where I specify initial RAM disk is where it is located, method is FTP server, and the IP address is taken from DHCP, boot device is link. And second is install CentOS 8 with web server and kickstart file. So kernel is CentOS 8 vmlinuz and initial RAM disk, and these are the initial, the parameters, kernel boot time parameters. Interesting parameter is this method, that is HTTP method, kickstart file location, how you specify the kickstart file, that is on the web server under inst folder ks.cfg file is my kickstart file. boot device link, DevFS, no mount, and VNC based installation. And the password for VNC server is this: inst.vncpassword is equal to passwd or password. Now we need to look at this file, where this file is located. On my web server this file is available. I can directly open it using link. So you can see the file. This is my kickstart file, ks.cfg file, and this is the file which I'm going to explain to you for my installation purpose and in the presentation. So this file is available through this web server, and the same menu is available. What is there inside that where www/html, and here I have this folder inst and ls-al. You see the ks.cfg file is available here, and I can verify ks validator and then ks.cfg. If there is no output, that means the file is okay. So this is the kickstart file which was available through the web server. This kickstart file is fetched. Now if I install, and the PXE server is configured, this is one directory. Okay, let's go back one by one. Find FTP install, we change the permissions 444 for files, and for directory is 755. Change the permission on this PXE Linux 755. That is pxclinux.cfg and pxclinux.cfg/default. And then enable TFTP server, enable FTP server, status FTP server, status TFTP server. The TFTP server, as I said, is available for the remote serving of ks.cfg file and other files. Then firewall settings. What firewall settings are required? Very interesting. Because it took me quite some time, no documentation available on internet for firewall settings, and I struggled a lot to set up the firewall, because I never wanted to disable firewall or to disable SA Linux for the installation purpose. That is the reason I figured out, and I set the right permissions, and all these permissions are available. Sorry, all these ports are open in my firewall. Interesting point is this: if you don't set these ports open, if you don't open these ports in the zone libvirt, it'll not work, and nowhere you'll get this documentation. I actually went through the logs, was able to figure out that no, we have to set it in a different zone, because by default when you do, it works in this public zone. So I set this in this public zone, tried all these commands, but it failed to work. But when I set on this, I was able to get through it. So firewall settings are quite interesting. To show all these things, let's verify firewall -cmd -list -all. Now these are the default settings for your default zone, which is public zone. If you have to specify the zone, you have to specify libvirt. Zone is equal to libvirt, and these are the ports for libvirt. You see the default port, default zone is public, active, and this is the libvirt zone, and the settings are required here. This I took quite some time. I struggled a lot to figure out these firewall settings for libvirt zone, and then reload the firewall. The firewall settings, and then we also look at the HTTPD settings. I'm showing you all the commands at one place. I installed HTTPD, I started that, I enabled some booleans, and I checked the status. These are the commands which will install and set up the HTTPD server for my system, for my installation tree. Where my DVD is available, let me see, /mnt, if it's available right now, sorry. Yes, it is not available right now. cd/mnt ls, it is not available. So I mounted the DVD on this. My DVD is available under varlib. Let me show you. Libvirt and boot. Under that I mounted, I have my DVD available. So from this directory, because this is the default directory for KVM based installation, all the images are stored under this directory only, here under images. Whenever you create default location, this is the default location, and this is the for bootable media. So I put my DVD under this, the ISO file under boot directory, and all my images, my machines are available, the images for the machines are available under images directory. So I mounted this, let me show you. You see the directory is mounted here, mount hyphen o loop, and from this directory I'm mounting it under slash mnt. So let me mount, and this is mounted now. Once it is mounted, I copied the content as I demonstrated in my examples. I copied the content to the respective directory. One is slash where slash www slash html slash inst. I copied here. Second, I copied where ftp inst. I copied here. I copied these files in these locations. So the file copied at the right location, anaconda-ks.cfg file was a file used to create my kickstart file. We need to look at the kickstart file installation also. Now let's try the installation using kickstart file. So for that I'm simply going to this my virtual machine manager where I have all my machines. Let me delete some of the machines, I don't need them now. Let me delete. There's a clone. I don't need to save space, I'm just doing it. Now create the new machine. Now remember, I'm going to use network boot PXE, and I have set up the PXE server. I'm searching for the right image, CentOS 8, forward. Remember, PXE boot will not work if you use less than 2 GB RAM. So let's keep 4 GB RAM to make it faster boot. I have 16 GB RAM, good. I don't have any space problem on my system, and this is my server. One is my name of the machine, which is going to be the name, and finish. And now you will see the PXE boot. Now you know the geographical region, now you know the understanding from where the PXE file will be served, where the kickstart file will be available, from where the menu will come, what packages you need to install, what services you need to start, all these things you have seen. And I have set up this machine as a PXE boot, and this is the menu which is appearing, which I showed you just now. So PXE boot, Skillpedia, you click on this. This will install CentOS 8 from web server and the kickstart file which I showed just now. And you'll see everything happening so quick. It will not ask anything because the kickstart file will answer all the questions which are required. By chance, if there is any question missed in the kickstart file or kickstart file have errors in that particular command, no worry. Because then the installer will stop at that point and will ask you that question. And after that it will going to be manual process. So as long as everything is set up properly, correctly in the kickstart file, it's not going to ask you. Now the installer is available through VNC. You can see the IP address of the VNC, 192.168.122.196. Right? Let's try and access it through the VNC viewer. So here we have VNC viewer. And I'm going to use that. So it is 196 was the IP address, 196, connect, and the password PASSWORD, which I showed you, which is specified in my parameter. And now you see the installation is going on and is not going to ask anything. It will install, it will set up everything. From where it is set up, where it is getting the answers to the questions, it is getting the answers from the kickstart file. That is what you will learn. Let's understand the kickstart file till the installation is complete. So in general, retain the order of the directives. However, some variations is allowed depending on whether the installation is from local media or over a network. You do not need to use all the options. If you leave out a required option, the user will be prompted for the answer. This is precisely what I told you. Don't be afraid to make a change. For example, partition related directives are commented out by default. Line wrapping in the file is accepted. If you leave out an option, installation process will stop at that point. It is best to test kickstart file on a test system, or even better, in an experimental VM, which I'm trying right now. So understanding the kickstart file, very important. The following is the code from my anaconda-ks.cfg when I created my RHEL7 based installation, but there is no difference at all. So first line tells that it was created for RHEL7, in my case for RHEL8 right now. So version equal to RHEL8. Next, authentication command to set up the shadow password suite, auth config, enable shadow, password algorithm, SHA512. And the next command to start the installation process from the first DVD or CD drive on the system, CD-ROM. In my case, I used URL, that is HTTP based URL. So, or if you configure NFS server, you can specify NFS server with -- directive. Directory is equal to /inst. If you are using FTP server, you can specify the FTP server URL. If the ISO file that represents the RHEL7 or RHEL8 DVD exists on the local hard drive partition, you can specify that also, like hard drive -- partition dev sda10, like partition number 10, and the directory is temp-sang1. If it is available, you can supply that also. The first boot, this option, this directive, first boot -enable, it runs the setup agent during the first installation. As there is no way to set up a kickstart file which answers to the first boot prompt, that -- disable directive helps automate the kickstart process. That's why I disabled first boot -- disabled. The ignore disk directive that follows specific volumes, that specifies volumes only on the noted VDA drive, like ignore disk -- only use VDA. And then we have language keyword, language specific directive, and the keyboard specific directive, and the character set specific directive, self-explanatory. Then the required network command is simplest, and if there's a DHCP server on the local network, so network -- device ETH0 boot pro 2 DHCP. In contrast, the following two lines configure static IP address information with a noted network mask -- net mask, gateway address -- gateway, DNS server, name server, and computer name, host name. So directive will be network -- boot pro 2 static device ETH0 gateway 192.168.122.1 IP address of the machine, net mask of the machine, no IPv6 means I don't want to use that, name server, and activate the network. Network hostname server.example.com. Please note that all static networking information for network command must be on one line. Be aware, if did not configure networking during the installation process, you could either use the kickstart configurator to help set up that directive or configure networking after the installation is complete. As for the password for the root user, is a part of RHEL7 installation or RHEL8 installation process, the kickstart configuration file can specify that password in encrypted format. Because the associated cryptographic hash function is same as used for etc shadow file, you can copy desired password from that location here. In fact, it is better to use this is encrypted. With this directive, use the encrypted password. If you don't use this -- encrypted, you can supply a text password also without using this encryption. Then we have time zone directive. Time zone is like how you specify is UTC. Then additional users which you want, would definitely you would want to create after the installation is complete, that is additional users. User, group, wheel, name, sang1, passwd is encrypted. Alright, you specify that. As for security, firewall directory can be optionally be added. For example, firewall -- service SSH. For SC Linux directives, it's simple. You can set that also. It is optional, like enforcing or permissive or disabled. In my case, I enabled that, and SC Linux is equal is -- enforcing. The default bootloader is grub2. You can include a -- boot drive switch to specify the drive with bootloader, and an append switch to specify parameters for the kernel. bootloader, location MBR, boot drive VDA. Now, it is important to clear some existing set of partitions. First, clear part, --all, init label, drive is VDA. That will clear all partitions on the VDA virtual hard drive. If it has not been used before, you can use --init label initialize that drive. So this will clear the partitions, clear part, --all, init label, --drive, VDA. Changes are required in the partition directives that follow, and they should also specify the directives, file system format, that is --fs type, and size in MB. And this will create the partitions. The part command is the only command which supports the scripting, and that's why we use part command. Here, interesting point, we cannot use fdisk here. We cannot use, there is no other utility we can use, and the part utility can be used here to create partitions using the kickstart file, during the kickstart file. Kickstart file can configure physical volume, PVs, or volume groups, VGs, and logical volumes, LV, in that order, and the order is important. Similar to what's shown here, like part, PV01, FS type, LVM PV, on disk VDA, size this. Part, /boot, FS type, XFS, on disk VDA, size 500. Partition, swap, FS type, swap, on disk VDA, size 1000, volume group, RHEL, and the size, PE size, that is physical extent size 4096 and PV01. Similarly, LVM logical volume /FS type XFS. So you specify the LVM directives also in, if required, in the kickstart file. The default version of kickstart file may contain a repo directives. It would point to FTP network installation source and should be deleted from the command out of the kickstart file, like repo name Red Hat Enterprise Linux base URL and cost this. So this set the priority. If you are using an existing KVM based VM, it may be necessary to shut off the system to change the boot media from CD or DVD to the hard drive. Shutdown, and then the package list. This is the list of packages, percent packages. Here you specify what all packages you want to install on your target system using the kickstart. After the package group are installed, you can specify post installation commands after the following directive. For example, you could set up a custom configuration file. However, %4 directives and anything that follows is not required. This is what. Finally, we verified our kickstart file using ks validator command, ks validator and the file name ks.cfc. We verified that file. I repeat, all these commands, the example kickstart file which I have used is available on the blog. I'll show you that. That's all for this session. Let's look at the blog now, which I was trying to show you. The installation is going on, as you can see. And let me show you from where you can actually try this. Now go to the blog section and you see virtual machine with KVM, and this lab setup is complete. Actual the lab setup which I created, which I showed you the kickstart file and the networking and everything, the firewall setting, everything is available here. You see the commands and the kickstart file also will be available. So this is the blog which you should search. You should go through other blogs also. Subscribe to this website, join this website, and subscribe to the channel to get updated on latest lectures, because I'm going to present you the entire lecture series on RHCSA and RHCE. There are 74 lectures to be precise. I'll show you that lectures also.